be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory
to you, O Lord.
At that time, the Lord appointed 72 others, whom he sent ahead of him in pairs to every town and place he intended to visit. He said to them, "The harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest. Go on your way. Behold, I am sending you like lambs among wolves. Carry no money bag, no sack, no sandals, and greet no one along the way. Into whatever house you enter, say first, 'Peace to this household.' If a peaceful person lives there, your peace will rest on him, but if not, it will return to you. Stay in the same house and eat and drink what is offered to you, for the laborer deserves his payment. Do not move about from one house to another. Whatever town you enter and they welcome you, eat what is set before you, cure the sick in it, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God is at hand for you.' Whatever town you enter and they do not receive you, go out into the streets and say, 'The dust of your town that clings to our feet, even that we shake off against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God is at hand. I tell you, it will be more tolerable for Sodom on that day than for that town.' The 72 returned rejoicing and said, 'Lord, even the demons are subject to us because of your name.' Jesus said, 'I have observed Satan fall like lightning from the sky. Behold, I have given you the power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and upon the full force of the enemy, and nothing will harm you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice because the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Through the words of the Holy Gospel, may our sins be blotted out. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, at the center of today's gospel stands the main message of the church, the main message of the gospel, the main message of Jesus Christ. Behold, the kingdom of God is upon you. Now, one of the lines that critics of the Catholic Church like to level against us is this. They say that Christ came preaching the kingdom, and instead what came was the church. And they mean this as a disparaging way to suggest that the Catholic Church and her hallmarks, the priesthood, bishops of the church, are some kind of an accretion, some kind of a corruption of sacred scripture, not to be found there but added later. Of course, we could pause to reflect for a moment that scripture is itself a product of the church, not the church of scripture, and that sheer logic dictates that the church accordingly is possessed of more, therefore, than that which is to be found within the strictures of sola scriptura. One of the ways in which the Protestant reformers sought to ridicule the church was by rejecting the Old Testament used by the Catholic Church, the Septuagint, the Greek version of the Old Testament translated at Alexandria in Egypt. The Catholics used this as the basis for their Old Testament, and the Protestant reformers elected instead to work from a Hebrew version of the Old Testament that they had in their possession. Their logic seemed incontrovertible at the time. If the Old Testament was originally written in Hebrew, as it was, then why would one work from a Greek translation? Why not use the Hebrew original? Fast forward several centuries, and with the aid of scientific and archaeological discoveries, it emerges that the Greek Septuagint, which from the start the Catholic used for its Old Testament, was indeed the version used by Jesus and the apostles and quoted in the New Testament and used in the early churches. And the Hebrew version preferred by the reformers turned out to be a version compiled by rabbis of Judaism after Christ's resurrection, by rabbis who were anxious to refute the claims of Christians that Jesus was their Christ. Instead, the Catholic Church continues to look back to those 72 rabbis who were commissioned in Alexandria in Egypt long before the birth of Christ and the birth of the church. Those 72 rabbis who were sent to go away independently and each of them to translate into Greek the Old Testament, and how the miracle happened that the 72 returned to find that each of them had rendered a translation exactly like everyone else's, which anyone in translation knows is a human impossibility. And so these 72, these translators of the Septuagint, find themselves true collaborators with the Holy Spirit who inspires all of Scripture. So much for looking back before the birth of Christ, before the birth of the Church. In tonight's Gospel, we have Christ commissioning another 72. These 72 collaborators to go out, two by two, and accomplish Christ's own task in the various scattered communities to which he would bring the good news. Note well that these ministers are not commissioned after the resurrection, after Christ has returned to heaven, but well during the earthly ministry of Christ and at his own authority. And they come back to him full of joy, having swiftly run their command, collaborators before the face of the Most High God, which is the closest definition to the priesthood one could fathom. One of the beautiful aspects of our gospel this evening is it shows just how much Christ stands at the center of all history and looks forwards and backwards at the same time, taking it all in a single vision. There he stands in our gospel tonight, commissioning the future priesthood of the Catholic Church, just as he sees in them a continuity of task with the 72 rabbis of old, commissioned to give the future Jesus and his apostles the version of Scripture they themselves would pray in and quote in their practice of the faith. And there he is, commissioning them to go out of the ark of the church, two by two, just as two by two he had them come into the ark of Noah to safety and salvation from destruction due to sin. There stands Christ in the center of our gospel, in the center of all cosmic history, and he is able in a glance to see Satan right at the beginning fall from the heavens like lightning, referring to that original rebellion of the angel of light who became the angel of darkness because he refused to accept a Christ who would come up upon us like a lamb among wolves. Power is headily intoxicating, and Lucifer instead would have God brandish his power like a sword, smiting his enemies and those who would insult him by their sin. Instead, the Father maintains course and sends the Lord of history into our turbulent, unwelcoming world as the Prince of Peace. A little babe in swaddling clothes, vulnerable, dependent upon us, needy, born to displaced parents who rapidly become refugees, himself carrying no purse, no scrip, no shoes, a lamb among wolves, our Christ. Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold, God's kingdom of peace draws nigh upon you in this way, like a mother consoling her children in the heavenly Jerusalem. Accept his peace, and his hand shall be upon you, and your bones will flourish like herbs, which is a clear prophecy of the resurrection of the flesh. But refute his way of peace, as Lucifer did, and it will go worse for you on that day of harvest than it did for that quintessential civilization of sin, Sodom. And we, who as Christians would style ourselves other Christs, do well to follow suit and do likewise. This is why Paul the Apostle in our second reading would have us glory in nothing of our own. We glory only in that mark of defeat, which becomes the mark of victory, the cross. We glory in the cross of Jesus Christ. It is the quintessential symbol of defeat replaced by victory. We bear within us no marks of our own glory, neither by circumcision or by uncircumcision. We bear within us the marks of the crucified ones, the ones who carry with Christ the cross of human history. Nothing of the logic of earthly power will avail in us in that dread hour of the harvest. This is why Christ says to his 72, "Rejoice not that the devils are subject unto you, but rejoice in this, that through baptism your names are written in heaven." There stands Christ at the center of our personal history and at the history of all salvation history. And he shows us the prophet Isaiah foreseeing the end of human history in our first reading. Christ's coming will bring upon us his civilization of love, the heavenly Jerusalem, the opposite of Sodom, a river of peace, not selfishness. Dear brothers and sisters, in this year of faith, commit yourselves to pray the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into his harvest. For the fields around us are white with harvest and will wither on the stalk without vocations from your communities, from your families, from among your children. Pray for vocations in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.